diversify as quickly as you can. Use your currency to go out and grow your business quickly and create critical mass, because as you create critical mass and scale, you'll see your cost of capital go down, your multiple go up, and that'll give you the ability to access capital more cheaply and deploy that capital into new royalty opportunities.
Welcome to the My Future Business Show, where we get you in front of your best audience and keep you there. Not only are we interviewing the biggest names in business to help you become even more successful, we're inviting you to book your spot on the show to help you grow your business. So at the end of the call, make sure you fill in the interview application form at myfuturebusiness.com/interviews. Hi, and welcome back to the My Future Business Show. My name is Rick Nuske. It's wonderful to have you here, just as it is to have David Garofalo with me. How are you, David?
I'm well, thank you very much, Rick. Great to see you again.
Now, you and I have spoken before, and there's been some exciting things that have happened at Gold Royalty. And for everybody who hasn't met David yet, he is the CEO, President, Chairman, and Director of Gold Royalty Corp. And we're going to be talking about, obviously, Gold and Gold Royalty Corp as an organization. But there's been a lot of new news that's come to the fore. But before we jump into that, for those who haven't been introduced to you yet, David, I would love to learn a little bit more about you. Let's start off with where's home for you?
I'm in Vancouver, Canada.
Canada, fantastic. Lovely place. Now, what's the weather like at this time of the year over there, David?
Well, fall is setting in, which means a little bit wetter, a little bit cooler, but still quite pleasant here.
Do you like the warmer weather or the cooler weather? What's your choice?
I like the warmer weather, which is why I'm on the West Coast. East tends to be quite cold in the wintertime. It really never gets any worse than a bit of rain here in the winter, and rarely below zero, other than the mountains where you can go ski. So,
do you like skiing?
I do. I've taken it up, and you can't live in Vancouver without liking skiing. It's everybody's DNA here, I'm afraid. So,
yeah, absolutely. Now, all work and no play makes David a dull boy. I'm wondering, do you get much time away from the workplace?
No, it's fair to say that with COVID, there's about 150 hours in the year where I'm not on a plane. And so it's allowed me to get out from time to time to cycle, ski, run. And I live on a mountainside near the ocean here, so it's an ideal place to have an outdoor lifestyle.
Yeah, fantastic. You know, this is important because it gives people the context and shares, I guess, a bit of the significance about this call. Now, with all that being said, when you were growing up, do you recall an event that stuck with you fondly? What was one fond memory that you might be able to share with us?
Well, I grew up on a street in North Toronto with all of my dad and my mom's siblings, and they had four each, and I had 30 first cousins, and we all lived in the same neighborhood, and we all played sports together, usually road hockey, and yeah. To this day, I'm still very tight with all of my cousins because we grew up together, and we followed each other's careers and family developments and evolutions, and that is the fondest memory, is the closeness I had with my extended family, and yep. And still have that today.
Yeah, those formative years are very important. Now, I know that your health is, you know, the probably most important thing for you to be at the top of the tree. How do you maintain, you know, your fitness and your health? What's a day look like for you, David?
Well, I always try to find an hour to 2 hours a day where I can work out. And so for me, that involves cycling. I row on a rower. Trail run with my dogs. Mm-hmm. And I hike from time to time. So I mix it up. And, if I have to extend my day to make sure I get my exercise in, I do. Yeah. So I always find a couple hours in the day where I'm actually working my cardio as hard as I can, and I think that maintains muscle mass, fitness level, clears your head. I think it makes me a lot more productive, and yep. I've heard that time and again from some of the most successful executives.
You know, you talk about rowing and just sort of getting away and clearing your mind. Does it make a difference to just sit quietly and be with yourself for a little while if you're trying to work through problems?
Yeah, you know, it does. And, I found that now that I've pursued more of an entrepreneurial lifestyle, I do find time to reflect and sit back. Gold Royalty is a startup company, mm-hmm. And has a half a dozen employees, and I could run a business 10 times the size with the same human footprint. And because I don't have operational responsibility for 15,000 employees as I did with Goldcorp, there is a bit more time in the course of the day to stop and think.
Yeah.
And be a bit more creative and strategic. And I have to say that at this point in my career, I'm enjoying that a lot more, and not running necessarily on a hectic treadmill, as it were, and I can find time to actually think and act strategically.
Yeah, that's excellent. Thank you for the feedback. I guess you've got to find the shoe that best fits you, don't you?
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely. Now, just to, I guess, share the significance of your background, you've had some involvement. You were instrumental in the Newmont and Goldcorp merger. I was wondering if you could share that with our audience.
For sure. I actually initiated a strategic process when I was at Goldcorp in the fall of 2018, mm-hmm. When it became evident there was going to be consolidation at the top. Barrick and Randgold had launched their merger right in the midst of our process, and we initiated some conversations with a number of our peer companies in the space to ensure that we would remain competitive in terms of our cost of capital, our production profile, our cost base, and whatnot. And that ultimately culminated in a merger with Newmont to create the world's biggest gold company by market cap and production levels. And that was a difficult process and a long process. We went through a number of months of talking to a number of parties to make sure that Newmont was the right fit. But ultimately, it was the right thing to do because the company significantly re-rated after that merger, mm-hmm. And vastly outperformed Barrick and Randgold to the point where the shareholders of Goldcorp, who tendered into that bid, ended up seeing their investment triple in size from the pre-announcement price when you incorporate both the share appreciation and the dividends that have been paid out from Newmont since that merger was completed. So it was definitely a financial success for our shareholders and I think a successful success for Newmont as well, because it perpetuated one of the oldest gold companies in the world, 100 years since its listing this year, and you really set it up for the next century.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And that's just one of many major projects that you've been at the helm of, as it were. Now, I'd love to share for those who are on the call with us today, David, what Gold Royalty Corp is actually all about, because it's a very interesting business model that investors can look into.
Certainly. I mean, we were created really from a concept a year ago to what's now going to be on a pro forma basis, almost $800 million market cap company listed on the New York Stock Exchange. We IPO'd back in March, initially with a royalty portfolio written on the development assets of a gold company called Gold Mining Inc. And we started with 17 royalties written on those development stage assets, raised $90 million US on the NYSE in March. And then shortly thereafter, announced a merger with a like-sized company called Ely Gold, another mm-hmm. royalty company with assets predominantly in Nevada and Quebec. So it really fit and complemented our portfolio quite nicely because we're America's focus, and we were, and now we're still exclusively America's focus, but we went from 17 royalties to almost 110 royalties as a result of the merger and doubled our size from a post-money valuation on the IPO of $200 million US to $400
wow.
with Ely. And then we completed that merger in August, and then yep. within a week, we announced a three-way merger with Golden Valley Mining and Royalties and Abitibi Royalties, who collectively own a royalty, among other things, on the largest gold mine in Canada, Canadian Malartic. And so that brings a foundational asset into the portfolio to complement the substantial royalty portfolio we already have. You know, that deposit produces about 700,000 ounces of gold per year, is moving underground from open pit with a $1.6 billion expansion by Agnico and Yamana, the operators, which will see our share of the cash flow expand dramatically over the next 3 to 5 years as they complete that expansion. And, you know, as Gold Strike is to Franco-Nevada, Canadian Malartic is to us. You know, yep. this is our Gold Strike. This is our foundational asset. But they also bring a substantial royalty portfolio over and above that in Quebec and Nevada as well that complements our portfolio. So collectively now, after we complete this merger, we'll have almost 200 royalties in our portfolio, six that are producing, seven in construction, and then a broad array of portfolios, royalties in our portfolio between early stage exploration through to feasibility study. So again, collectively almost 200 royalties, but within the next 3 to 5 years, 13 or 15 of those will be actually producing. And we see our cash flow actually increasing fivefold over the next 5 years as many of those construction projects start to bear fruit.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about cash flow. What is the way forward for that, you know, the trajectory of your cash flow income over the next few years?
Yeah, so as I said, we see a fivefold increase. Yep. And we see beyond the next 5 years, a substantial increase beyond that, because as Canadian Malartic moves underground with that significant infrastructure, they're sinking a shaft, they'll get underground drill setups to delineate that deeper resource. Now, they already have collectively about 4.5 million ounces of gold reserves in that asset, but we believe there's at least 6 to 8 million ounces of underground potential. And having operated in that district myself for many years, I helped build the Troilus mine in northern Quebec back in the 1990s when I was with Inmet. And then I was at Agnico Eagle for 12 years from 98 to 2010 through their formative years when they were building three mines in the direct vicinity of Canadian Malartic, Laurent, Goldex, and Lapa. And what I've learned from the geology in that Abitibi Greenstone Belt is when you get the underground infrastructure in place for production, you also get underground setups for exploration drilling in deeper horizons. And that opens up these deposits geologically to find more ounces. And that certainly was the case, for example, at LaRonde, which initially started off as a small zinc deposit from surface drilling. But as we sunk a shaft into that deposit, initially down to 1,000 meters, and started to drill from underground, we decided to extend the shaft down to 2,200 meters. And now they're mining down to 3,000 meters in substantial gold and copper resources there. And that gold deposit, LaRonde, is now the largest gold-bearing VMS ever discovered in the history of geology and mining.
Now, just for everybody who doesn't understand what VMS is, I do. Could you maybe share a little bit about what that means? Because it means that there's something else going on, isn't it?
Well, it's a volcanogenic massive sulfide deposit. That's what VMS means. And generally, VMSs are characterized by large sheets of mineralization, highly disseminated mineralization over these large sheets with a lot of continuity, so that you can drill these deposits out with large areas of influence around your drill holes and extrapolate ounces much more readily than you could, for example, in a vein deposit, an epithermal vein system, where you have to kind of follow the vein. It can zig and zag, it can narrow, it can thicken.
Yep.
Whereas with VMSs, it's like a sheet of mineralization, much, much easier to drill out and extrapolate reserves and resources from.
Yeah, thank you. I love that. Love that insight. Thank you very much. Now, what attracts the caliber of yourself to an organization like this startup? What was the thing that made you go, yes, this is for me?
Well, there's a few factors. One is where we are at this point in the cycle. And we've gone through almost 6-7 years now of significant underinvestment in the gold sector in terms of exploration and development. Mm-hmm. And what that's meant is a substantial decline in gold reserves, down about 40% over that period from peak reserves. And that significant amount of reinvestment means there's going to have to be a catch-up in the sector, both on the base and precious metal side, for that matter. There's been a period where we've gone through, mining companies have been focusing on deleveraging, harvesting returns, dividends, share buybacks, all the things that good businesses do. But of course, our business is a little bit unique in that our reserves decline. When our reserves decline every day, we die a little bit. Every time we mine, we die a little bit, unless we're reinvesting back in exploration and development. That hasn't been happening. And so against a backdrop of significant inflation in the general economy, which we're experiencing now, and the need to see a catch-up investment back in the ground by mining companies, both on the base and precious side, I'm forecasting a significant escalation in input costs, both on the capital and operating side. And that need for reinvestment means, you know, they're going to need more capital, the mining companies, in order to reinvest back in the ground. And royalty companies have always been an important part of the ecosystem when mining companies have needed to access capital to build new mines. And so I've positioned myself within a royalty company for that reason, foreseeing the need for capital, particularly among the emerging producers and the smaller explorers, but also I wanted to insulate my shareholders from mid-cost inflation. I wanted to give them a leverage proposition to gold because I still am very, very bullish on gold.
Mm-hmm.
I'm concerned that mining equities will underperform in the rising coal price environment because their costs will inflate dramatically. And so royalty companies offer you that top line exposure, a percentage of the revenue, and leverage the expiration because if the deposit grows, our royalty grows with it.
Yep.
But because we're only taking top line exposure, we don't care what the input costs are, and nor should our shareholders. We're insulated from that. And so that's really the beauty of the royalty model and why I'm positioned at this point in the cycle in this type of vehicle in my career. The other factor, of course, is the quality of the assets, the foundational assets that gold mining had. You know, collectively, those assets had 32 million ounces of gold resource on a gold equivalent basis. Those are chunky assets, and those development stage assets are dear right now because the industry hasn't been investing in exploration. And I expect as mining companies turn their attention to replacing their depleting production and reserves, these assets will become quite attractive and realize a significant re-rate. And by extension, the royalties that we have on them will achieve that re-rate. We got a good valuation for them in the market in our IPO as Gold Royalty Corp. And I use that currency to immediately diversify. It's a very similar model to what Wheaton Precious Metals pursued 15 years ago when they were spun out of my old company, Goldcorp, by Ian Telfer.
Yeah,
it's no coincidence that Ian's on my advisory board as chairman.
I was going to ask you about Ian in a moment.
He's done this before.
Yeah,
and sorry, I blanked myself up there. He's done this before, and I rely on his advice, having gone through this before. And his secret was write royalties on what you have, which is what we did with Gold Mining's assets. But then diversify as quickly as you can. Use your currency to go out and grow your business quickly and create critical mass. Because as you create critical mass and scale, you'll see your cost of capital go down, your multiple go up, and that'll give you the ability to access capital more cheaply and deploy that capital into new royalty opportunities.
Earlier, we touched on some investments and acquisitions. I'm not sure if we touched on the recent strategic investment in Prospector Royalty Corp. Could you talk about them?
Well, you know, that's part of a broader initiative to create royalty generator platforms within our own company. And we're doing that in a couple of respects. Mm-hmm. One is in acquiring Ely Gold, we not only acquired over 100 royalties, but we also acquired two individuals, the co-founders of Ely, Trey Wasser and Jerry Brofman. And Jerry's a prolific prospector in Nevada. And almost every royalty that Ely had in his portfolio, Jerry generated organically with Trey's help. And what I mean by that is he staked exploration claims in Nevada and then farmed them out to companies to invest in the ground and took a royalty back in the farm-up process. He created those royalties himself very, very cheaply. And we're keeping him on board as we are Trey to continue that model in Nevada exclusively. Similarly, in taking over Golden Valley and Abitibi, we're inviting Glenn Mullen to join our board and continue to do the same thing in Quebec, which he's done with considerable success over decades. And again, most of the royalties we acquired, expect to acquire in that three-way merger, Glenn generated through the same sort of royalty generator model that Jerry and Trey pursued in Nevada. And then finally, you asked me about PRC, or Prospector Royalty Corporation.
Mm-hmm.
That's a private company run by Tim Young, himself a very, very well-known prospector in Canada, a very successful one. And in PRC, he's digitized terabytes of exploration information and royalty information, overlay the royalty information over the exploration details and data that he put in there, digitize that, and using the predictive analytics within that digitized database to find more royalty opportunities. Again, organically, we have a right of first refusal on everything they find. And we made a small investment, $2 million into the private company to help stimulate their search process. So we have three platforms, distinct platforms, generative platforms within the company now to complement, you know, the clear expertise we have in our board management on the M&A side.
I'd love to talk about the people that are on the ground, and because Gold Royalty don't necessarily, I don't know as much, but do you have teams of GOs that work on your behalf? What sort of influence do you have over the way exploration actually occurs?
Well, we don't conduct exploration ourselves. No. In pursuing the generative model that we have being run by Jerry, Glenn, and Tim, who are all very accomplished geologists,
yep.
they're essentially just staking claims,
yep.
which is very, very low cost, and then farming the properties out to explorationists who want to put capital into them. So they're the ones that are raising the capital and expending the money on exploration. We're taking back royalties in return for farming out the properties. So if ultimately they find something of any significance, they're the ones that are going to undertake all the technical and capital risk associated with building those mines out. We only put a dime into them. Our investment, which is quite small, is made at the early stages when we stake the properties.
So it's all on the balance of probabilities and what you see in the deposits and what's the likelihood of success. So there's obviously ongoing risk management involved in all of this.
Well, it's really mostly neurology. If you think about it, we're in very prospective districts in Quebec and in Nevada in particular, under Glenn and Jerry's leadership respectively. And we're staking claims very close to existing operations, existing exploration prospects that have been quite successful, and using that to create opportunities for further exploration by our exploration partners. We're not actually conducting the exploration, we're farming it out. And you're right, it's a matter of managing probabilities, mm-hmm. Staking as many claims as we can in geologically prospective districts near accomplished explorationists who have access to capital for exploration, having them invest in the ground and then reaping the benefits if ultimately they find something that's economic.
Could you share a little bit about this? Because I know people that will be on this call today, David, they don't know anything about this business. I certainly do. I'm wondering if you could give a very brief overview of how this is different than investing directly into a mining company, but also because you have a precious metals focused royalty site and streaming. What does the streaming component mean as well, please?
Well, it's not really much different than a royalty. With a royalty, you're getting, you know, sometimes 1, 2, 3% of the underlying revenue coming from a mine.
Yeah.
With a stream, you'll get that in physical deliveries of gold. That 1, 2, 3% or you know, could be a little bit higher in physical deliveries of gold at a fixed price, well below market. A stream and a royalty are really only distinct in the fact that with a royalty, you're getting cash payments. With a stream, you're getting physical deliveries. Then you sell the gold after the fact. But you're getting, again, a fixed percentage of the production or a fixed percentage of the revenue, as the case may be, whether it's a stream or a royalty, respectively.
Now, why would your organization be a good way to invest in gold as opposed to, you know, just buying straight bullion directly?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, you know, the advent of the ETFs made it very easy to own physical gold. You don't have to line up at a bank and find somewhere to store your gold. You can do that, obviously, and some people, yeah. You know, have enough capital to make, you know, make it worthwhile to actually yeah. have some sort of storage.
Yeah.
But other people want to take advantage of the economies of scale that an ETF offers, like the GLD on the New York Stock Exchange, which is physically backed by gold. So you get your physical exposure that way.
Yeah.
The one disadvantage you have in that, of course, is that that gold doesn't grow. It actually diminishes a little bit every year because some of it has to be sold off to pay for the storage costs. You don't get the exploration upside. So when you're buying in a royalty company, you're getting effectively the leverage to the gold price that an ETF provides,
yep.
but you're also getting the exploration upside. So if the operator is successful in drilling out their deposits and growing them geologically, that royalty is adhered to any geological upside as well. And so you have a potential to actually grow your gold exposure volumetrically as well as participate in the upside that the gold price offers you.
We touched on this a little earlier, but I'd love to get your opinion, your feedback on the fiscal system. We seem governments tend to have this willingness to just leave the printing presses running day and night and just pumping out paper money. How will gold be buoyant against the standard greenback, as it were?
Well, look, I think we're in an environment where we're going to see quantitative easing for the foreseeable future.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to see interest rates lower for longer. We've seen really unprecedented amounts of debt strapped on by sovereign nations across the world, not only in response to the pandemic, but even before then. Now, the pandemic's only amplified that dynamic. And their only practical way and fiscally responsible way for these governments to manage that debt is to debase their currencies and by extension debase the debt denominated in those currencies. And I, you know, these governments are never going to be in a position to repay the debt, so they're going to debase, inflate their way out of the debt. That's the bottom line. In that environment where really there's an infinite amount of paper currency that will be introduced into the system, gold is very finite in quantity. It's a very minute amount. It's been mined since the beginning of time. It's 200,000 metric tons. We're only adding 4,000 metric tons to that supply per annum. And in fact, there's a remarkable inelasticity of supply to price. As the gold price has been going up the last several years, supply has been going down because of the aforementioned underinvestment in exploration and development.
Yeah.
And the lead times for new properties can be decades. It's not like we can flick a switch and add capacity in response to a higher gold price. The barriers to entry are extremely high. It's a very capital-intensive business.
Yeah.
It's socially complex and complex from a regulatory standpoint to get new deposits up and running. So you're not going to see a supply-side response to higher gold prices for the foreseeable future. Even if there is a significant discovery tomorrow, we're not going to see the benefit of that for 15, 20 years or longer.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, we talked about selection, project selection, I guess, cursorily earlier. I'm wondering, do you concern yourself with, you know, local society? Do you look at access, infrastructure and the likes when you're getting involved?
Sure. From a royalty perspective, we are not the operator, so we're not making decisions on the ground about how we're going to invest in social infrastructure or physical infrastructure.
Of course.
But when we're looking at royalty opportunities, we look at it through that lens. We want to ensure that the operator has the capacity financially and from a technical and social standpoint to actually undertake the plans that they've advertised to the market. Otherwise, we won't put capital to work. ESG is a very, very important filter for us. So we want to ensure that we're with operators that operate safely, environmentally responsibly, run a diverse workforce, have good social engagement with the surrounding communities. Otherwise, we won't put capital to work. In fact, since we launched Gold Royalty earlier this year, we've looked at a number of royalty opportunities where we had to pass for that very reason. We didn't feel comfortable that the operator had the sufficient capacity or track record to operate responsibly in all those fronts that I mentioned earlier on.
So there are times that you'll say no. That's very
absolutely. I mean, you know, ESG is one criteria. The other is we expect to get double-digit rates of return on the capital invested. So sometimes we've had to pass on royalty opportunities because we didn't feel we could be competitive and get the right rate of return for our shareholders. But also, if their ESG practices are not up to snuff, we're just going to simply pass.
So with your expanding portfolio, David, it would be apparent that you'd be striking other metals in all those various projects. Now, do the investors see the upside to that, the benefit of those exposures?
Well, you know, our focus is, not exclusively, but it's a very, very tightly focused on precious metals. In fact, nearly 90% of our exposure in underground royalties is gold and silver. You know, actually 88% is gold, 2% is silver. So very, very gold focused. And we think that's important. We think investors prefer focus. We've seen a proliferation of royalty companies that have come into the space over the last couple of years. We've actually absorbed three of them that were gold-focused. There are a number of them that have tried to branch out and diversify into other metals, and I think that erodes the focus and erodes the multiples and ultimately raises your cost of capital and makes you uncompetitive for new royalty opportunities. So we're going to stay exclusively precious metal folks, but you're correct to point out that from time to time, there are byproduct metals in these gold deposits. You know, we have 5 billion pounds of copper exposure in some of these development stage assets that we have, but they're predominantly gold deposits with some copper byproduct in them. Copper is not a bad place to be in, but it represents less than 10% of our exposure.
In terms of investors, you'd have various types of investors. For those who are risk averse, not willing to sort of lose their money, how does the, how do you protect your investors when the price of gold drops?
Well, you know, the thing is our revenue doesn't disappear, you know, because we're getting a fixed percentage of our gold or of the revenue of the underlying mine. So we're always going to have a substantial revenue base regardless of where the gold price is. And we have a very, very small G&A footprint, very few administrative costs. I have a half a dozen employees and I could run a business 10 times the size with the same human footprint. We don't have a lot of G&A to cover. So we're very well insulated to lower gold prices because of our low cost structure.
I'm wondering, who is gold royalty as an investor suited to? Mum and dad investors, large, medium size?
I'd say ones that are concerned about inflation. You want to be in gold as an asset class, but if you're also concerned about inflation and input costs, it's a low risk, high value way to play the gold sector, because again, you're not having to worry about the margins at the mine because we're only taking a percentage of the top line of the revenue. Yep. We have very, very low costs and we're going to have a very stable cash flow, even a low gold price environment. And that'll give us the potential to pay dividends. So really, effectively, what we're doing is buying annuities from these gold mines. And they can go up and down with the gold price, but they'll never go to zero. And our cost structures are always going to be low enough that we can comfortably insulate ourselves against a downdraft in the gold price. So I think it's a very risk-averse way to play gold.
Yeah, absolutely. When I'm investing, I'm always looking at the people behind the organization. I see somebody like you pop up and it grabs my attention. But could you share with us, please, David, the team that are involved at Gold Royalty?
Yeah, I mean, collectively, there's over 300 years of experience within our management and board. And I'd say it's largely skewed towards operating and development expertise. Within my board, I come from an operating background, over 30 years of mine building and operations.
Yep.
In my rearview mirror. Also within the board, we have Alan Hare, who's my successor at Hudbay Minerals when I ran that base metal company for half a dozen years. He was my chief operating officer. He's a metallurgical engineer. Alistair Still, our director of technical services, a geologist by training, and like Alan, a prolific mine builder and operator as well. Sam Maher, VP of project evaluations, came out of SSR. Before that, Wheaton Precious Metals. He's an experienced mining engineer with significant operating experience. And so you can see that our board of management has a very significant technical bias. Yep. Because ultimately, when we're looking at opportunities, we do a bottom-up due diligence. We do a lot of work on the geological model to convince ourselves that the ounces are there, that they're advertising are there, but that there's exploration upside beyond that, because that gives our shareholders optionality. It gives leverage to the exploration success. You don't pay for that, but that's the gravy, that's the icing on the cake, if ultimately the operator is successful on their exploration side. And then people like Sam do a lot of technical due diligence on the operating capabilities of our operating partners to make sure that they can do what they've advertised to do, so they can deliver the returns that our shareholders expect.
Yeah, it's wonderful feedback. Thank you very much. Now, there's certainly a lot more that we could discuss. Time is flying through. I'm wondering if people want to learn more about yourself, David, and your team at Gold Royalty, where are they going to go?
Well, it's hard to forget. It's goldroyalty.com. It's a very generic name. And it's amazing that we were able to protect the name when we decided to name the company Gold Royalty.
Wow.
And it was a lot easier than I thought it was going to be. So it's easy to remember. Also, we're G-R-O-Y-G. We're on the New York Stock Exchange American.
Thank you so very much, David. Now, if you're on this call, this is the first time you've been exposed to David and Gold Royalty. I hope you're as excited as I am about this opportunity to get on board and have a look closer to Gold Royalty and everything that they do. And with all that being said, David, once again, thank you very much for joining me on the My Future Business Show today.
Thank you, Rick.
Thanks for joining us today. If you enjoyed the call, then make sure to subscribe, leave a comment, share us with your friends, and book your spot on the show at myfuturebusiness.com/interviews. And if you're looking for solutions that will help grow your business, then visit myfuturebusiness.com/shop.